he like for me to say to his people this day, wherever they are, all over the world, yes, we have a universal ministry, because we are talking about a universal kingdom that's going to come. And Almighty Eternal Father is going to be on earth dwelling. And so he gave me this morning to talk about strength. How many of you need some strength today?
Amen.
Yes.
Huh?
We all do.
Well, we always know that our strength should be in the Lord. And we all should know that he will strengthen us. And I'm going to use some scriptures, and if I have a chance, I'm going to talk about our spiritual warfare that we are in. Mm-hmm. And we definitely need this strength to encourage us and to keep us strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Yes. That's why he tells us to put on the whole armor of God, so you may be able to stand against mm-hmm. the wiles of the devil. But I just want to use a few scriptures. Number one I'm going to talk about is Nehemiah 8 and 10. And it says, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Nehemiah 8 and 10. And it says, a wise man is strong. Yea, a man of knowledge increases strength. And if you get the knowledge of God, which come along with wisdom and understanding, you're going to increase your strength. And that's what we need to do. We need some strength in these days and time, because the devil is on the loose and he's running wild. So we got to be able to stand against these wiles of the devil. Hallelujah.
Yes.
So also that's Proverbs, the 24th chapter and verse 5. And in Isaiah 40 and 31 it says, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Do you feel like fainting sometimes?
Yes.
Do you have any control over you fainting?
Yes.
If you have control over it, why do you?
Yes. I can do all things.
You don't know the joy of the Lord is your strength. So you can't faint. The weary might faint, you know, but only you're weary when things are not going like you think they should go. And all the time, our way is not the best way.
Amen.
Most time, God's way is the best way.
Amen.
And following in his footsteps, doing what he tells you to do, then you can have that strength. Amen.
Amen.
So I just want to go to Daniel, the book of Daniel. And I want to read a few things out of the book of Daniel about something was happening. And it was told to him. O man, greatly beloved, fear not. Peace be unto thee. Be strong, yea, be strong. That's the 19th verse. And when he had spoken unto me, Daniel said, I was strengthened and said, let my Lord speak, for thou hast strengthened me. See, when the Lord appears to us, he's so strong and powerful. This word has got so much anointing in him, till our human mind can't stand up against it. Moses was told to fall on his face when he went to that bush that was burning and it wasn't consumed. Different ones were told to fall on their knees because the ground they stand on is holy ground. But we know today that we are the temple of the living God. Our bodies, he wants us to keep them clean and pure so he can use us. You know, we used to sing that song, I'm gonna live so that God can use me anywhere, anytime, any place. That's the way saints are supposed to be, living so God can use them. See, and when he comes to you, you're going to get weak because he's strong, right?
Amen.
But your strength is in him. The joy of the Lord is your strength. So when you have joy in the Lord, you are increasing your strength. And what God is doing, He's getting you ready for that great day. And it's a great day coming, saints. And who shall be able to stand? The battle of Armageddon is coming. The man of sin is coming. The image is coming. It's going to be set up. You can't buy or sell unless you have the mark of the beast, his name, or his number. And this beast is going to rule and reign for 3.5 years. And it's called the Great Tribulation Period. Who shall be able to stand? Will you be able to stand? But in Acts, the first chapter, verse 8, we're just going to read something that what Jesus told the people when he got ready to leave. Acts 1 and 8. When you get it, say amen. I'm going to let the Bible speak a little bit.
Amen.
It has been speaking through me. Spoke to me earlier this morning. Acts 1 and 8. What does it say?
Well, you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost is come upon you.
You shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost, or the Holy Spirit, or the Kadosh Ruach, or the anointing. Because in Isaiah 10:28, it said, it is the anointing that break yokes. And if you have yokes in your life and ties that bind, get what Jesus, Yahshua, or the Holy One of Israel, uses for your strength. And it will make you an overcomer. Acts 1 and 8, when Jesus got ready to leave, Yahshua. Now, I use both names. I use the name of Jesus because it was given to me. Now, if you want to use the Hebrew name, that's up to you. If you don't, it's still up to you. Because you know your God just as well as I know mine. Or you should. And I think that I have that Holy Spirit that's leading me and teaching me and guiding me. I'm not bragging. I'm just telling you like it is. And what I got, God told me to give it to you. Freely as I have received, freely give. And whosoever is under the sound of my voice and hear this word of God that's coming forth, it's up to you to decide. It's not up to me. You know, old folk used to say down south, every tongue up got to stand on its own bottom. And that's the way it is in life with my God. Can you say hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
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 Don't say it like you're scared. Say it like you mean it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. What does the Bible say in Acts 1 and 8? Let the Bible speak.
And ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth.
Now, Jesus is telling these disciples to go back to Jerusalem and wait till they be endowed with power from on high. And that power is the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And they were told to go back and wait. And in the process of waiting, he had shown himself with many infallible proofs over 40 days and 40 nights. But he's getting ready to leave now. But he told them to go back and wait till you get some power so you can go and carry my word in righteousness and in truth. So, when the day of Pentecost would come, it wasn't but 120 in the upper room, but they were on one accord. And that's what we have to do, saints. All of these churches and us have to get together and get on one accord. See, what we think might help the situation that's going on in the world, can't nobody help it but God.
Yes.
Amen.
It's all in His hand. He's all knowing. He's all powerful. He's all present. Amen?
Amen.
So, once we receive what he said we would have, we'll be able to do what Philippians 4:13 says. Philippians 4:13. we'll be able to not only say, but we'll be able to do what he wants us to do. See, we don't know what God wants us to do until we get in him and let him get in us. Because he plainly tells us, my ways are not your ways, neither is my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the heaven is higher than the earth, so is my word higher than your thoughts. Amen?
Amen.
So what does Philippians 4 and 13 say?
I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me.
You'll be able to say, I can do all things through who?
Christ.
Meaning the anointed one or the Messiah that strengthens you. That's where your strength comes from. Your strength comes from the Lord. And when you get that other sense, which I call the sixth sense, and that's the ability to think before you act, then you can do all things through Christ. Because you're not going to jump out there flying solo, doing things on your own. You're going to let him lead you and guide you. Amen?
Amen.
Because that's what he said the Kadosh Ruah, the Holy Spirit, would do. It would teach you and lead you and guide you unto all truth. And it will bring back to your remembrance the things that he said, Yahshua, Jesus, the Holy One of Israel. So we just thank the Lord that he had brought us into this point. So the Word of God becomes the energy of God in you. And while you're there, just read that 19th verse in that same chapter, what it says.
But my God shall supply all your needs.
But my God shall supply all of your needs.
According to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus.
Let's read that again. Can everybody got it? Let's read it together. But my God shall supply all of my needs. According to his riches in glory.
By Christ Jesus.
Now, this we should know. Amen?
Amen.
So that's about the strength of the Lord. If you want some strength, your help comes from the Lord. And we ought to depend on him. Because he hasn't made any mistakes yet.
Yes.
What's going on in the world today? He foresaw it. He foretold it through his prophets, through the people that he used, and our forefathers. But thanks be to him that he predestinated us to be his people of today and of this time. So therefore, we have to be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the works of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now let's talk about our warfare. You might wonder what's going on, why things don't go like you want it to go, and why things don't happen when you want it to happen. But God has a time schedule, and he has planned, and he is doing things according to his plan. Because if man had obeyed him, he wouldn't have to go through all of these things that he's going through. Amen?
Amen.
He put two trees in the garden side by side, and he would come down every day in fellowship with man. But man, it was another man that was an angel that was kicked out of heaven in the Garden of Eden. And you can read this in Ezekiel, the 28th chapter, about Cyrus, the prince of Tyrus, I'm trying to say. And that wasn't talking about the man. Oh yeah, it was a man during that time, but it was somebody over that man.
Satan.
Huh?
Satan.
Huh?
Satan.
Did he have another name?
Lucifer. Devil.
Huh? Lucifer. What else?
Devil.
The devil. The dragon. He had a many names, just like God got a many names. Huh? He's an imitator. Isaiah 14 chapter say, I'm going to be like him. So that's what he's doing. He is like him. The world, the Bible said that he had deceived the whole world. And if it's whole, it's not half. And if it's whole, it's not three-fourths. It is A-L-L. none left out. Amen?
Amen.
So we are today in spiritual warfare. It might look like it's men doing things that's contrary to God, but they have somebody over them that is a spiritual being, that is a fallen angel, who is called the son of the morning, a bright star, Lucifer, the devil. So he knew he couldn't take over from God, but he said, I'm going to be like him. And you know what? Today he is like him. The Bible said he's the God of this world. We know who owns it, don't we?
Yes.
But we know who's ruling it, right?
Yes.
Under the leadership of the God of this world. Amen? So we're going to talk about spiritual warfare. In 1 Corinthians, the 10th chapter, verse 13, we like to go there first. And we're going to let the Bible speak and the Word of God tell us about our warfare. One of the greatest things in the world that we have to look out for is temptation. Huh? Because when you yield to temptation, you're yielding to Satan and you're sinning. And the Bible says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. I want eternal life. I got eternal life. And ain't no devil in hell, out of hell, around hell gonna convince me that I don't have it. Because John 3:16 tell me about that. Amen?
Amen.
Let's let the Bible speak.
1 Corinthians 10 and 13.
Yes.
There have no temptation taken you but such as in common to man.
Uh-huh.
But God is faithful.
God is what?
Faithful.
He is full of faith. Faithful. Uh-huh.
Who will not suffer you to be tempted above.
He's not going to allow you to be tempted above what?
That ye are able.
No temptation that he's not going to allow you to come up on you, that if you're in him and he's in you, that you won't be able to endure and stand. That's what that means. Amen?
Amen.
All right.
But. Will with the temptation also make a way to escape.
He'll make a way for you to escape. Uh-huh. And what else?
That ye may be able to bear it.
That you may be able to bear it.
Yes.
In other words, you'll be able to go through these things that come up on you.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
So you have to be strong in the Lord to do that though. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. Go back to verses 3 and 4 and let's see what did it say. And the same, 2 Corinthians, I'm trying to say. Verse 3 and 4. 2 Corinthians 3 and 4.
Chapter.
2 Corinthians, I'm trying to say. Verse chapter 10, verse 3 and 4. It's amazing, both of those in the 10th chapter. One thing I like about God, Yahweh, Jesus, Yahshua, He does everything decently and in order. And that's what we need in our lives, order. Amen?
Amen.
All right. What does it say? Let's read.
For though we walk in the flesh,
uh-huh,
we do not war after the flesh.
See, our warfare is not in our flesh. It's in our spirit. Huh? Read.
For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal.
What we're fighting against, our weapons are not carnal. You can't see them. You know, they're not atomic bombs, hydrogen bombs. They're not AK-45s or 95 or whatever they are. Them guns and all of these things that people think guns are everything. And the gun laws that they pass and all of these things that's going on in the world, that's not our warfare. Our warfare is, read on.
but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds.
See, our warfare is against strongholds, things that hold on to us strongly, which is hard for us to get rid of. Some people it's alcohol, some people it's cigarettes, some people it's drugs, some people it's coffee. Some people have to have their coffee, you know. They're hooked on it, you know. I hope the coffee industry don't send nobody after me, but I got to tell it like it is. Not only that, chocolate, some people like it, just hooked on chocolate. Huh? Oh, you say I'm meddling. No, I'm trying to get something over to you. A point. Okay, read verse, was that three?
That was four.
Okay, read four again.
For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds.
So, in other words, it's not carnal. It's not nothing that we can see with our natural eye. We got to get in the spirit, look out and know that there's another world out there. We are flesh and blood. It's a spiritual world out there. And then when we go to Ephesians, the sixth chapter, and it tells us how to prepare ourselves for this warfare. Ephesians, the sixth chapter, and we'll start at verse 11. Let the Bible speak.
Put on the whole armor of God.
Okay, I want to, is that 11? Go back to 10. Because it says, finally, my brethren, I think. Is that what it said?
Yes.
Finally. Finally means last of all. Finally, my brethren, put on the whole armor of God. Read. That you might be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Read.
For we wrestle not against flesh and blood.
We are not wrestling against flesh and blood.
But against principalities.
It's principalities. These are angels. Principalities are angels. Uh-huh.
Against powers.
And against powers.
Against the rulers of the darkness of this world.
And against the rulers of darkness, those that's in darkness of this world. They are ruling this world. Uh-huh.
Against spiritual wickedness in high places.
And spiritual wickedness in high places. That means the highest places that's on earth is our churches. That's supposed to be representing God and His Son, Jesus, and the priesthood that was left that we were under. But I think God, Yahweh, that we are under a different priesthood. A priesthood that's after the order of Melchizedek. Of this priest who came through the lines of Judah. In Genesis 49 and 10, it says, the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come. We know who Shiloh is, don't we?
Yes.
Who?
Jesus.
Huh?
Jesus.
Huh?
Jesus.
All right. Y'all sound like you ain't got no energy. Remember, the joy of the Lord is your strength. Huh? You know, when the Holy Spirit came, they were all together in one place, on one accord, and they were praising God. They were lifting up God. We want miracles from God, but we're not willing to do what He tells us to do. We are supposed to be happy. When we come into the house of the Lord, we are not supposed to be ashamed. It was thousands and thousands of people in Chicago, in Cleveland, Ohio, all over rejoicing for the Cubs. And they weren't ashamed.
Preach.
And we come into the house of God and getting the word of God, we don't want to open our mouths.
Preach.
Saints, not ain'ts, saints I'm talking to. Throughout the world, I'm not just talking here, I'm talking to saints all over the world. If you can rejoice and get out of your shirt and out there in the wintertime and cheer for football games and football teams and drink your beer and do your barbecuing and everything, how come you can't do something for God? You got to come sit up looking like you dead. Don't do that. God don't want that. God wants you to have joy. The Bible says, take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. Don't go in the house of God looking like you dead. You're alive. And it's not just for today, but it's for tomorrow and forever. Because God getting us ready for the world tomorrow. He said, one shall chase 1,000 and two shall chase 10,000. You can't even chase one with that attitude.
Come on, preach.
Your attitude determines your altitude. If your attitude don't take you nowhere and keep you down, you're going to be down. But the word of God said that you are a royal nation. You're a kingdom of priests. You're highly favored. And you got to sit around and look like you are a peach. Not a peach, I mean a
lemon.
Lemon. Persimmon. You know, we shouldn't do that, saints. We shouldn't be like that. I should be able to look and see smiling faces. I know they don't tell the truth all the time, but sometimes they do. A man called me, saw the show on TV. He said, you look so sad and sorry. I said to myself, what is wrong with that man? You know, I'm one of the most happiest creatures that I know about. And that's a hyena. He laughs all the time.
Okay.
Do you know when I laugh, I only upset 14 nerves? But when I frown and look ugly, I'm upsetting 84 nerves. Do you know I'm cutting off my lifespan doing this? Not smiling, not being happy. I say I ain't gonna let nothing steal my joy. I mean that. I got joy, I got strength, I got health. I got what God said I would have if I obeyed Him. That's why I'm gonna obey Him. I'm not gonna let nothing steal my joy. And I say, hallelujah. Hallelujah, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
You know, we got to be happy, saints. If not, be one of those great pretenders. You can laugh and act like, but you don't have to act like. You act like a child of God that's receiving the blessings of the Lord. Because the blessings of the Lord maketh rich and add no sorrow to them. Why should we be sorry? Jesus said in John 14:1, let not your heart be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. Huh?
That's right.
In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Are you looking for the future? Are you looking for Tuesday?
Amen. Come on.
Have you cast your vote yet?
On Jesus.
I'm an early voter. I voted years ago.
For Jesus.
Huh?
Amen. And Isaiah, the government shall be upon his head, not on this earth. Come on.
The government that I'm looking forward to is upon Jesus Yahshua's head.
Everlasting.
It's an everlasting government. And Daniel, I just want to go here because I love that prayer and I learned it. After Nebuchadnezzar had that dream and his soothsayers and his magicians and all those people couldn't tell him what he had dreamed. And that's really kind of unusual, isn't it? If I come up to you and ask you to tell me what I dreamed last night. And I couldn't forget it because it pertained to me, but I couldn't remember it either. So he said, "You guys are so smart, you're supposed to be my counselors. Then tell me what I dreamed. You're supposed to be so smart." They say, "Oh, King, nobody on earth would ask nobody to do something like that." He said, "Well, you've been lying to me." And then one little fella having to think about Daniel. And he said, "There's a young man of the Hebrews, and he got some friends, and he can interpret dreams and tell you about them." He said, "Send and get him." He sent and got Daniel. Daniel came and said, "Oh, King, give me a little time. Let me go talk to my fellow saints." See, sometimes we need to talk to our fellow saints.
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Yes, sir.
Well, praise the Lord.
Amen.
Is that Sister Carol?
Yeah.
Well, praise the Lord. Good to see you, my sister. Well, anyway, we thank the Lord that Daniel, not me, my forerunner, he interpreted the dream. And he went back and told his fellows about it, his friend, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. One guy called him something else, the big bad Negro, one of them. But anyway, he went back and told them. And you know what? God revealed it to him that night, what this king had dreamed. And he said, "Blessed be the God of our Father. Forever, forever, and forever. For wisdom and might is his. He changed the times and the season. He removes kings. He set up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those that know understanding. He revealed the deep and secret things." That's Daniel 2:20, in case y'all want to read it sometimes. "He knows what's in the darkness, and the light dwell in him. I give thanks and praise to thee, O thou God of my Father, for thou hast given me wisdom and might, and you have made known unto me all the king's matters." See, we have to know when God does something for us to thank him for it.
All right.
Huh?
Amen.
Don't forget Esther. And Mordecai.
Saved a nation.
She saved a nation, and that's why I got up off of women so much. Because God does use who he wants to use, when he wants to use, and how he wants to use. And if you want to talk about a virtuous woman, read Proverbs, the 31st chapter. And if you want to talk about that other kind of woman, read Revelation, the 17th chapter and the 18th chapter. There's two differences. Now, if you want to read about our spiritual woman, our mother, wisdom, which come along with her knowledge and understanding, read Proverbs, the 8th chapter. And you'll read in there that she was with God, Yahweh, before anything was made. She was his daily delight. He rejoiced with her inside of him, making him happy. Huh?
Amen.
And that's what women are supposed to do for their husbands. They came out of the man, and if they pattern after their spiritual mother, they learn how to make their husband happy. All right? Some don't have them, some have had them. You know what I mean? And they're gone for different reasons. But if the joy of the Lord is our strength, and we are rejoicing in the Lord, we're not supposed to let anything take our joy.
Amen.
Did you hear what I said?
I heard you.
We are not supposed to let anything take your joy.
Amen.
Because that's your strength in the Lord. Huh?
Amen.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
This is sound advice. This is from my spiritual mother, wisdom. Huh? So don't bring me Adam and Eve. Bring me the foundation. Because Paul say, no other foundation can any man lay except the one that's laid already. Everything, everybody came out of God, Yahweh. Huh? Everything. Yahshua himself came out of God. When he spoke, Yahshua performed. Even though he wasn't called Yahshua then, he was called the Word. Huh? All things were made by him, and without him was nothing made that was made. All right? Huh?
Amen.
I veered a little from our spiritual warfare, but I'm going to get back into it. So you read 2 Corinthians 3 and 4. It bears repeating. Read it again. 10, 3 and 4. Well, in case you don't have it, it says,
I have it.
All right.
For we walk in the flesh.
For though we walk in the flesh,
we do not war after the flesh.
We do not war after the flesh.
For the weapons of our
warfare
are not carnal,
but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. So what is a stronghold?
A yoke.
Yeah.
What is a yoke?
Something got a hold to you.
Huh?
Something's got a hold to you, weighing you down.
Make you feel uncertain.
Huh? Come on now. Huh?
Stronghold.
It's a stronghold. It's something that affects you. You want to get rid of it, but you don't know how to get rid of it. So you say all the time, all of my help come from the Lord. Well, you got to examine yourself. What are you doing while the Lord is not helping you? You got to question yourself. Are you being true to Him? Or are you out there half-stepping? With that Frank Sinatra syndrome. I did it my way. Huh? But that's our war, that's our weapons to war with. And as Ephesians says, go there, the sixth chapter, and we were there, I think, when I stopped, wasn't it?
Yes.
What verse? 10, I say.
I read 10.
Okay, keep on reading.
11,
what did 11 say?
Put on the whole armor of God.
It's telling us how to prepare ourselves for this warfare. You got to put on the whole armor of God, not half of it, not three-fourths of it, not 99 and a half. That won't do it. You got to put on the whole 100% plus. Huh? Read.
That ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil.
That you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. It's devil got all kinds of wiles out here that can get your attention and cause you to get off course. Get off that train that's bound for glory. Huh?
Amen.
I don't care what you see out there on the outside and you on the inside, you stay inside. Because you get out there, it might change and be just the opposite of what you think it is. Huh?
Amen.
I'm talking the Word of God from what He has given me. Alright? So, what else does it say?
Verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood.
We are not wrestling and fighting and warring against flesh and blood.
But against principalities.
Yes. Fallen angels.
Against powers.
That's ruling and authority. Yes.
Against the rulers of the darkness of this world.
Uh-huh.
Against spiritual wickedness in high places.
Spiritual wickedness is in high places, and it started in high places because the devil has got his man just like God has, he has his man. God's got Jesus or Yahshua. Satan has got Santa Claus. All right. Santa, if you rhyme it out and write it out, it means Satan. Why? Because he's full of lies. Number one, he's coming from the North Pole. Number two, he got a sled and reindeers. Number three, he comes and come down your chimney. Number four, if you don't be good, we use to guess our children. Santa Claus ain't gonna come to you. And all the time, Santa Claus is with you all the time, buying your groceries and paying your rent. Huh? Mm. Huh?
Amen.
Oh, boy. Hallelujah. Read on, sister, read on.
Verse 13.
Uh-huh.
Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God.
Don't take some of it, take all of it. Uh-huh.
That ye may be able to withstand in the evil day.
That you be able to withstand in the evil days.
And having done all.
And now the evil days are coming up on the world now. We can see, according to the way the governments and things are going, that people that's qualified to take over and rule, they already got money. They already using money. And they already trying to get more money. See, it's just like a cancer. If you don't take some to cause it to regress, it's going to keep on building. It's going to keep on eating up your body. And that's the way money is. The love of money. It don't say money is. It say the love of money is the root of all evil. I'm telling you like it is, saints. Read on.
And having done all to stand.
After you've done all to stand, still stand. Huh?
Amen.
Therefore, having your loins girded about with what?
Truth.
And having the helmet of salvation. Huh?
Yes.
And the word of God. Who is the Word of God?
Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Huh?
Jesus.
And above all, huh? Mm-hmm. Put on the helmet of salvation. The helmet, protect your brain. Be careful what you let come in and what you put out. Because you can't put out no more than what you let come in. You're a walking computer. Huh? Garbage in, garbage out. This word of God in, the word of God out.
Yes.
Huh?
Amen.
The word of God ain't gonna just jump into you. You got to study to show yourself approved unto him, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the words of truth. That's what we have to do. Read on.
Well, verse 14. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth,
uh-huh.
And having on the breastplate of righteousness,
uh-huh.
And your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace.
In other words, don't let your feet carry you where peace is not. And where it's going against the gospel of the word of Yah, or the word of God. Don't let your feet carry you. Always let them lead you in the path of righteousness and truth. Amen. Read on.
Verse 16.
Above all these things.
Taking the shield of faith.
Take the shield of faith. In other words, protect your faith. See, it's a faith that starts in Romans 1:17. It says from faith to faith, Romans 1:17. And then you got a ever-increasing faith, which is your shield. It's faith on top of faith. In other words, getting a double portion of faith, getting more faith. And that faith is going to get you closer and closer and closer to God. You're growing in grace and in the wisdom and the knowledge of God. That's how you're going to grow. You won't want to eat crackers anymore or drink milk anymore. You want the sincere milk of the word so you can eat some meat. As you grow, this is meat I'm talking, y'all. You might hear me say some things that you haven't heard before, but call me up, 773-568-2146, and we can talk. I don't care. It doesn't matter what religion you are. It doesn't matter what race you are. It doesn't matter to me. The Word of God is the Word of God for everybody. God is no respecter of person. Only one He respects is those that respect Him. Are you kind of that way? Huh? Yeah. Okay. Solid means consent. Read on.
Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye may be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked.
So you want to quench some fiery darts that the wicked is shooting at you. You got a shield on that's going to stop them darts before one strike you in your heart. And you end up double dead. I'm going to figure that one out.
Yeah.
Wow. Hallelujah. Read on a little more, Tessa.
Verse 17.
Uh-huh.
And the helmet of salvation.
And the helmet of salvation. Protect your brain. Put something on your head other than your scarf or your hat or your cap. Don't put it on your head. Put it in your head.
That's the salvation of God.
And that's the helmet of salvation in your brain. Know that you've been saved.
Yes.
Know that you have received Jesus Yeshua as your Lord and Savior. Know that you've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Know that you belong to God and don't belong to yourself anymore. Know that He that's in you is greater than he that's in the world. And that's my last scripture. That I'm going to, but finish this one.
And the helmet of salvation.
The helmet of salvation
and the sword.
And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. What else?
Verse 18. Praying always with
praying sometimes.
Praying always.
Praying once a day.
Always.
Praying twice a day.
Always.
Prayed three times a day.
Always.
Somebody asked me, how many times should you pray? Whenever you feel like it.
When you don't feel like it.
You
better
keep
praying.
You don't.
You better learn how to pray when you don't feel.
Amen.
Because that's the time you really need to be praying.
Amen. Amen.
Oh, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'm really enjoying myself this day.
Praise God.
I'm enjoying it, you know. Read on a little more, sister.
Praying always with all prayer and supplication.
You got to learn
Spirit.
How to pray with prayer and supplication in the Ruach, the Kadosh Ruach, the Holy Spirit, the latest thing that came from heaven, which gives you another sense to go along with them five, and that's the ability to think before you act, because the cemetery is full of people who didn't think before they acted. The jailhouses are full of people who didn't think before they acted. Because the Bible says, be careful what you say. Because death and life is in the power of that little thing right there. Who can tame it? Jeremiah says, the heart is deceitful above all things. Who can know it? So we need to know something about ourselves. You know, who made us? What made us? What did He use to make us? Whose image are we made in? Whose likeness are we made in? Whose do we belong to? I don't own myself no more. I used to thought I did, but I didn't then, because I always paid taxes. They always took out of my check what they wanted to take out. 25% or more, God said, you robbed me because you won't even pay 10%. And saints, lots of times we rob God. We do everything we want to do and put God on the back burner. Well, the Lord knows my heart. Sure, he knows your heart. Satan does too. But I ain't going to get into that. Come on, give me a little more.
Verse 18. Praying always with all prayer and supplication.
Sometime with all prayer and some supplication.
Always.
Always. Do this always. Read.
And watching thereunto with
and
all
watching
perseverance.
Watching thereunto.
With all perseverance.
With all perseverance.
And supplication for
and
all saints.
And supplication for all the saints. We got to pray for one another. Instead of condemning one another, we got to pray for one another. That the will of God take forth in each and every one of our lives. We got to pray for others. And while we're praying for others, we pray for ourselves.
Amen.
Huh?
Yes.
Amen.
Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Huh?
Amen.
Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Huh? 1 John, what is that 19, verse 19? 1 John 4 and 4, what does it say?
Ye are of God, little children.
This is what God is saying to us, little children. He always calls us the children of Israel. The children, not the grown folks. We're still children, but we got a children's mentality. Huh? So, what did you say again?
Ye are of God, little children.
You are of God, little children.
And have overcome them.
And you have overcome them.
Because greater is he that is in you.
Because. Why because? Because. Huh? Because greater is he that's in you than he that is in the world. You know who's in the world, don't you?
Yes.
If you don't, read 1 Corinthians the 4th chapter. 1 Corinthians the 11th chapter. Satan got angels out here, and they can transform themselves into ministers of light. Amen? So when you delay about, you delay your reward. Because you know you don't have to wait till the battle is over. You can shout now.
That's right.
Why? Because greater is he that's in you. How's my time, Brother Ray? Huh? Okay. Praise the Lord. Okay, so greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. All right? So, saints, ain'ts, whosoever, whatsoever, believe me, you've gotten the Word of God. Whether you believe it, obey it, it's up to you. He give us choices. And when we make choices, we take chances, especially if it's not in the Word of God. Because the Bible says, make sure your sin will find you out. So you got to be careful in this world today. You got to put on the whole armor of God so you can stand against the wiles of the devil. All right?
Amen.
You in spiritual warfare. Your enemy is not the person you see. It's what's inside of that person you see. Huh? Your God is not a God that the world can see. Only you can see him. All right? And we hope and pray that the word was enlightening to you today, wherever you are, whoever you are. And we ask the Lord to continuously bless his word and bless you to continue in his word. He said in John 8:31, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciple indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Whom the Son set free is free indeed. Are you free indeed?
Yes.
Thank the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.